Hey, welcome to Fox Fight Game. I'm Mike Straka, and we're going to talk to Bjorn Rebney, the CEO of Bellator, just signed a new deal, April 2010, live fights on Fox Sports Net, and reruns and highlights on NBC and Telemundo. Bjorn Rebney joins me now here on Fox Fight Game. Thanks for coming in.
Thanks for having me in.
This is a very big step for you, and how quickly you made this transition from ESPN Deportes to Fox Sports Net and NBC. Right. Congratulations. How'd you make it happen so fast?
I appreciate you saying so fast, yeah, because it seems like it lasted forever. You know, we had a great season in season number one with ESPN. The traction was good. The fan response was good. The format worked. The tournament format worked. And we had some options. We had some opportunities, which is unique in the television game, unique in the fight business. But we had to match two different concepts at once. One, we wanted to reach a huge universe. We wanted to make it available to the English language audience. Two, it had to be a deal structure that worked for us. Had to be a deal structure so you and I could be sitting here 2 years or 3 years or 5 years down the road and still be talking about Bellator Fighting Championships. So when you could marry those two, the Fox Sports Network distribution alliance with NBC and Telemundo, made a ton of sense. A lot of work, lots of flights, but we got it done.
We know where Dana White and the Fertittas came from. We know where Scott Coker came from. We even know where Gary Shaw came from. Where the hell did you come from?
Well, I came from agency, representing athletes. I was working with Lee Steinberg, mm-hmm, for a number of years, and then I had a boxing promotion company with Sugar Ray Leonard called Sugar Ray Leonard Boxing that we had on ESPN. It was the highest rated fight show on the network for 4 years. And I was an MMA fan. I was an MMA purist. I loved it. I used to get the DVDs and I used to get the VHSs back when there were VHSs from Japan. And I just watched it. It was what I would do with my own money. I would buy the tickets. I would watch the shows. I would buy the pay-per-views. And I was just a fan of the game. I got one of those great opportunities where you have the chance to actually go into business in something that you love that you would do for free or pay to do.
Lee Steinberg, the famous Super Bowl party. I've been to that a few times.
Yeah, you and I both.
What did you learn from working with Lee? He's a legendary sports agent, if you guys at home don't know.
Yeah, I think to think through everything in terms of when you're really angry or when you're really upset, to take a step back, to never respond to anything just immediately and to give everything a lot of thought, because what seems to be too good typically is too good, and what seems to be too bad typically is not as bad as you think it is. And to just analyze research and know everything that you can possibly know about, whether it's the athlete or the promotion or the city or the marketing or whatever it is, to understand the dynamics behind it, understand the business drivers behind it, just information being key.
You know, that strikes me very well, because when I interviewed Lee Steinberg, I asked him what it takes for an athlete to be one of his clients. And he said, first and foremost, he's got to be a good person.
Right.
And it reminds me of what you said about Lyman Good when Lyman won the championship. Here's a guy who's in a place and he says, if I win, I'm going to take my sisters out of here.
Right.
And so what kind of fighters do you look for Bellator?
Guys that obviously have that Lyman Good backstory or the Eddie Alvarez backstory. But more importantly, obviously, than the backstory is the ability to fight at a world-class level, elite world-class athletes. And, of course, with this new alliance, 82 million homes on FSN and 112 on NBC and another 62 on Telemundo, it's about the best athletes from every corner of the globe, guys who want to control their own destiny, guys who ultimately want the determination of them becoming champion in their own hands, in their own elbows, their own knees. Those are the guys we want. Guys like Eddie Alvarez who want to fight 3 times in 3 months to make that determination to become the champion of Bellator. You know, driven.
Let's talk about that tournament structure. How does that work on television as opposed to the matchmaking structure?
Well, I mean, it is a singular thing that makes Bellator Fighting Championships different from the UFC and WEC and Strikeforce, all of whom do a magical job. And I watch their shows and I buy the pay-per-views of the UFC. But ours is a place that is more analogous to real sport. It's like football, basketball, baseball, hockey, soccer, golf, you name it, and the best play the best, and those who win make it to a final or a championship, and if you win, you're the winner, you're the champion. And that's what I thought was missing from the fight game. I thought that objectivity where fighters could ultimately just control how much they make, how often they fight, and if they become champion. I thought that was a huge thing that was missing from boxing and MMA, just as a fan, as a guy watching with a bunch of other guys drinking beer and eating pizza. That's what I looked at and thought, well, how did that guy get a shot at the title?
Right.
Why is that guy positioned as the number one guy to potentially fight X or Y or Z?
Well, when you say, I just want to clarify, when you say more analogous to real sport, you're not saying MMA is not a real sport.
No, I happen to believe that it's the greatest sport in the world today. It is the greatest combination of speed and power and technique. I mean, the evolution of this sport over the last you know, 10, 15 years that I've been watching, it's just been unreal. I mean, if you look at clips from a decade ago in the NBA, it looks similar. You look at clips from a decade ago in MMA, it's a totally different game. I think it's the greatest sport on earth. But when I say real, I mean competition, where ultimately the athlete determines if he becomes champion, as opposed to a shiny suit sitting behind a desk saying, hey, Hernandez versus Johnson, let's make that our title fight. That just is a disconnect. For me, as a sports fan, as a huge fan of MMA, I mean, and I watch everything. I watch Versus, I watch Spike, I watch HDNet fights, I watch Showtime, I watch everything that I can watch in MMA, but that's what I thought was missing.
What do you think your secret ingredient to you is? I mean, getting the ESPN deal was big in and of itself, and now this is an even bigger deal. And you're relatively new in the game, at least as far as fight fans are concerned.
Right.
How did you get to where you are so quickly?
Well, you know, I appreciate you saying so quickly. At the same time, many, many years ago, I was doing television. I was doing television production. I was doing agency work, and it was all centered around the fight game. So, you know, you're talking about back into the 90s that I started pitching ESPN in terms of boxing and in terms of doing a boxing show. So I understood you had to have television. You had to have a weekly driver, same time, same place, same channel. You had to have venue alliances. You had to know how to work with commissions. You had to bring sponsors on board that would promote your brand and what you were doing outside of the scope of just putting a sticker on the mat. I understood the drivers. So it's really been, you know, 20 years in the making to get to this point. And like I said, I was just blessed that I had the opportunity to do for a living something that I would pay to do for free. You know, but it was just getting all those different skill sets.
Yeah, I mean, note to George Greenberg, he will pay to do this for free. quickly, let's talk a little bit about CBS and Strikeforce, because
sure,
it looks like they're doing the same thing again. We talked about Kimbo Slice losing to Seth Petruzzelli. Now they signed Herschel Walker and Brett Rogers and Fedor. I mean, it just seems like they're going down the wrong direction. Again, why do the big networks constantly do this?
You know, it's an interesting question. I think the way that you can build a brand in this space up is to create stars who are world-class fighters and who have some semblance of a backstory, and to allow fans like myself or yourself to see them week in and week out, same time, same place, same channel. The special events as a standoff, one time where you don't get to see them week after week and you don't get to track them or learn about them, is a disconnect to me as a fan. And I know what you're saying. I mean, the Elite XC model was a failure. Scott Coker's got a tremendous track record in terms of promoting events and putting butts in seats, and he's had a great promotion for a number of years. It's not our model. It's different than our model in many fronts. I mean, you know, that we're looking for the Joe Sotos of the world, the Lyman Goods of the world, fighters who are just on the cusp. And if you give them the exposure and you give them that shot and that brass ring is sitting out there, they will grab it. They'll give it everything they got. Joe Soto was unknown last year at this time. He's one of the top 10 ranked featherweights in the world today. Lyman Good was known in the Northeast. You and I knew about him. But across the country, you'd ask guys in the West Coast of gyms, they never heard of Lyman Good. But now they know. Those are the kind of guys that we want to build up. And those are the kind of guys that are true athletes but happen to have great personality and great backstory. So it's just a different model. And who knows if it'll work. I hope, as a fan of MMA, that the CBS show does ratings that just pop out of the roof. I mean, I pray that it does well, because if it does well, the execs at CBS are going to look at it. Our execs at NBC are going to look at it, and they're going to go, this is awesome.
Right.
I mean, the Elite XC shows did unbelievable numbers. Those were freak-of-nature ratings. And yet it failed miserably because they put their money in an area in terms of fight promotion that wouldn't work.
They should have put their money behind Jake Shields and Scott Smith.
You're preaching to the choir. Right. Jake Shields is a world-class fighter. If you've got a fighter of that ability at 85 or 70, you take him, you promote him, you tell him backstory. He speaks well. He's a good-looking guy, and he can beat anybody in the world in any given night.
Right.
That's the guy you put your money behind. God bless Kimbo Slice.
Yeah.
I applaud him for trying, and he seems like a great guy. But he's surely not a world-class heavyweight fighter, nor may he ever be.
Correct.
And you can't, that's not the model. That's not what's going to work.